So you heard Dr. Ishtiaq Ahmed Saab. He gave us a very good overview of radicalism, its evolution, its roots, histories, the reasons it came up, and key turning points, and its modern perspective. But I think, to be very honest, and that's my closing, there are many questions we have to ask ourselves now. After giving him a hard time, I think we should confront ourselves with some facts and some questions. And some of them I have listed down. If West is becoming Islamophobic, and no doubt they are becoming Islamophobic, we see that every day, we taste it every day. So if the West is becoming Islamophobic, are we also not becoming Westophobic? Maybe before that or after that, as a reaction or as a pre-action. But it's a question we need to ask ourselves: how far are we neutral and not Westophobic? Then, have we in some way contributed to Islamophobia? We know radical parties, right-wing parties, we talked extensively about them. They have definitely, as Murgaisa also pointed out, they have definitely contributed to Islamophobia. They might be the reason for Islamophobia, but haven't we also in some ways contributed to that tendency? Now, we enjoy the benefits of a secular state, but why are we always against secularism? And not all of you, I mean, it's a general question. I mean, some people are not. Because we love it. We love secularism for ourselves when we live here. But when somebody says secularism in Pakistan to protect minorities, then we say, no, we don't want secularism there. But we love it here.
Yeah, for India as well.
When Modi has really turned secularism upside down, we all are protesting, see, India is no more secular, we want secularism in India. But when it comes to us, and again, coming to what Khan said, yeah, don't wish for others what you don't wish for yourself. So that's another question. Do we have any sense of loyalty to the country we are born in, raised, received education, and make our living in a relatively safe and good, positive environment? I mean, we see here, again, I'm not addressing any particular individual, but generally you see here a lot of people who have been so successful, and we might not have achieved this, even a fraction of this in some other country or our own country, but why are we so ungrateful, so unhappy, so bitchy, and sometimes also reject everything, no sense of loyalty? We say that, no, we belong somewhere else. But why we live here, as doctors have said, it's voluntarily. If we are so unhappy, then we shouldn't be wasting our life, throwing in our life away. Then how can some of these people radicalize to the extent that they voluntarily join ISIS and go to the fight? Okay, bit of extremism, okay, a bit of radicalization, okay. Asserting your identity is okay, asking for your rights is okay, but going to that extent that you say, no, I'm going to go to a distant country I know nothing about, but I'm going to pick up the arms and I'm going to kill some other people who have never done anything to me, who don't even have a country. So where does this come from? So we have to really ask these questions. And this includes not only marginalized people who are really, really marginalized, have nothing to lose, but this is now applying to many people who have been very successful in these societies and have achieved everything they wanted to achieve and they could achieve. And why do the governments bow to the unconstitutional demands of radicals, whether it's West or East? I mean, tons and tons of examples. We have Ahmadi economist, appointed by Pakistani government, but comes the pressure, no, because he can't be an economist in Pakistan or advisor to the government because of his faith. So why do the governments who say that they are against radicalism, whether it's West or right, it's the same. Holland, they say we are domine and a businessman. So, but the business interest always wins at the end. You can be both, but at some point, the faith and the commercial interest, they clash, and who wins? Always the commercial interest wins, and the governments, they bow down to the radicals. While many of us believe that the extremists are not really Muslims, we fail to condemn their action, and some gentlemen made this point. I mean, when something happens, we, of course, I mean, all of us sitting here, we say, no, that this is done in the name of Islam, this is not true Islam, and these people are not really Muslims who are doing all this. But nobody comes out outright in a loud voice and says, no, we have to stop this. We actually quietly somehow sometimes condone it, sometimes we don't, but we don't shout out loud enough like we should be doing. Why the policy talks tackling radicalization are conducted without considering the historical context, as Dr. Saab has explained to us, where all the roots are. So it's a holistic thing. If you want to fight radicalism or understand radicalism, you have to take a holistic approach and not just pick out the piece we think suits our arguments or confirms our point of view. And finally, what our response should be against Islamophobia. I mean, that's also important. It's not Europhobia. It's not the, I mean, another extreme reaction to an extreme reaction is not the proper reaction. You reminded me, this gentleman asking the questions, I mean, Faraz ka sher hai ek, Ameer-e Shahr Ghareebon ko loot leta hai, kabhi bahila-e mazhab, kabhi banaam-e watan. To ye humare saath jo hai, wo hamesha hota rehta hai. So now I think I will, this is my last sentence, we need to do a lot of soul searching, a lot of discussion and debates among ourselves. And I think Dr. Saab, thank you very much, you have provided a great impetus for food of thought. And I think you have just inspired a lot of people.